As you know, in March of 2011, there was a serious nuclear emergency at the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plant in Japan. And you probably also know that the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission geared up its emergency response organization to provide support to that country and to help this country understand what was happening overseas. Hello, I'm Rick Hasselberg with the NRC's Office of Nuclear Security and Incident Response. It's my job to train and prepare the NRC's reactor safety team to respond to emergencies that might occur here in the United States. During the Fukushima event, I was part of the NRC team that responded to the events in Japan. In this first video, I'm going to explain what happened at the Fukushima site. In the second video, I'm going to explain how the NRC responded to the incident. But first, let me offer some general background about nuclear power plants. Nuclear power plants produce electricity. They do this through the nuclear process of uranium fission. That process produces very hot steam that rotates an electrical generator. The fission process also creates radioactive materials. Nuclear power plants are designed to contain almost all of the radioactive material that they generate. That material is sealed up inside the metal fuel rods that make up the nuclear reactor's core. But radioactive materials produce heat as they decay. That heat, if not removed, even if the plant is already shut down, can destroy the reactor core and release the radioactive materials to the environment. Overheating reactor fuel can also generate flammable hydrogen gas. The greater the amount of fuel damage, the greater the amount of hydrogen that is generated. Hydrogen, when mixed with air at the wrong concentrations, can burn. At even higher concentrations, hydrogen can explode. This reality will become important when I discuss what happened at Fukushima. If the reactor core is damaged, the building that contains the reactor then becomes essential in limiting the radiological impact of the event. The containment for plants like Fukushima consists of a large steel structure that surrounds the reactor vessel and a steel donut-shaped structure located below the reactor in the shape of a donut. That lower structure is partially filled with reactor cooling water and is called the wet well. The upper structure is dry and is called the dry well. The dry well and wet well are connected by a series of pipes. Together, these structures form what is known as the reactor's primary containment. Surrounding and supporting the primary containment is a secondary containment, also called the reactor building. The Fukushima Daiichi site consists of six boiling water reactors. On March 11, 2011, only three of the site's six units were operating. The other three units were shut down for different reasons and had different amounts of fuel in their reactor vessels. At the moment of tsunami impact, the three- and four-story tall structures facing the sea and the turbine buildings at the site were slammed by waves 47 feet above sea level, much higher than the 19-foot tsunami the site was designed to withstand. The waves destroyed AC power generating and distribution equipment and flooded several battery rooms. Many structures facing the sea were completely destroyed. The combination of the 9.0 earthquake followed by the huge tsunami knocked out nearly everything. Backup power systems worked for a while, but the tsunami took out almost all vital AC power generating and distribution equipment. Without power, nearly all the redundant and diverse cooling systems and containment support systems were lost. Any emergency plans or procedures that relied on electric power were useless. Any expectation that relief personnel could provide the type of assistance that was needed were also in vain. The failure of core cooling systems resulted in core heat up. Decay heat from the reactor core increased coolant temperature. The water boiled faster. More boiling led to higher pressure and eventually safety valves opened to relieve excess pressure and prevent catastrophic failure of piping and components. When those valves opened, they reduced the temperature and pressure in the reactor vessel, but they increased the temperature and pressure in the containment wet wells. With no way to pump cooling water into the reactors, there was no way to make up for the water that was now exiting the reactor as high-pressure steam. With no source of cooling water, reactor vessel water level decreased as steam continued to be discharged into the containment wet wells. At different times, all three operating units reached the point at which the top of the reactor fuel rods was no longer covered with water. At this point, the incident was well into what we call a severe accident sequence. Sometime after uncovering of the top of the fuel, portions of the fuel rods reached a temperature of 2200 degrees. The fuel rods are made of a zirconium alloy called zircalloy. They contain the reactor's uranium fuel pellets and prevent the release of almost all the radioactive fission products. At temperatures above 2200 degrees, the zirconium in the fuel rods reacts violently with steam to produce four bad things. Rapid fuel rod degradation results in the inability to contain all the fission products. This results in the rapid release of some of the fission products, especially some fission product gases. As if fuel rod temperatures weren't high enough, the zirconium water reaction actually accelerates itself as it rapidly increases fuel rod temperatures in the course of the chemical reaction. And one more thing, the zirconium water reaction creates hydrogen gas. Hydrogen, when mixed with air in the right concentrations, can be flammable or even explosive. At units 1, 2, and 3, a huge amount of hydrogen was generated as the fuel rods were violently consumed by the self-sustaining zirconium water reaction. Core temperatures continued to rise. You can hardly call them fuel rods anymore, but some of the materials that used to be inside the fuel rods are reaching 3,000, 4,000, and 5,000 degrees. At those temperatures, five more bad things happen. Localized melting of the fuel. The hottest locations in the core start to melt. Relocation of fuel materials. What started out as melting at a few locations became a sizzling mass of molten material. As that occurs, many of the fission products that had been trapped inside the uranium fuel pellets were now released. The radiological impact of the core melt is huge. Materials that had been in solid form, sealed inside the fuel rods, are now in either liquid or gaseous form, and they are on the move. As the temperature went up, more and more radioactive material became available for release. The temperature of that sizzling mass of highly radioactive core material was higher than the melting point of the steel reactor vessel. So, if they came in contact, the steel reactor vessel would likely fail. This is the classic core melt scenario. Moving away from the core for a moment, containment temperature and pressure had been rising for some time. If some of that energy was not soon released to the environment, then the containment might rupture, something you want to avoid at all costs. Also in the containment, hydrogen gas had been building up. Recall that hydrogen is created as the fuel rods react with steam. The operators needed to vent the containment as quickly as possible. For use only under severe accident conditions like these, a special non-filtered ventilation pathway had been installed in these containments. If this hardened vent pathway could be used, containment's pressure and temperature could be lowered, excess hydrogen gas could be safely released, and the containment could then be resealed to hold in the worst of the fission products. But the hardened vents were not successfully operated in time to prevent extremely high pressures from failing the containments in all three units. With core meltdown and containment failure, Fukushima units 1, 2, and 3 were unable to prevent the uncontrolled release of radioactive material and hydrogen gas from the primary containments to the secondary containments. In the secondary containments, hydrogen concentrations reached flammable and then, in the cases of units 1 and 3, explosive concentrations. In unit 2, hydrogen ignited before it could reach an explosive mixture, but it burned continuously for several days. The events at Fukushima Daiichi were tragic. On the International Nuclear Event Scale, the Fukushima accident rates as a 7, a major accident, based on the amount of radioactive material released to the environment. Only one other nuclear event has been rated at this level, the Chernobyl accident in 1986. Prior to Chernobyl, the Three Mile Island accident in 1979 was the most significant commercial nuclear power plant accident. We learned a great deal from the accidents at Three Mile Island and Chernobyl, and we are learning from Fukushima. By understanding what went wrong, we will be better able to identify and implement ways to make nuclear power plants safer.